All four words. Not five words.
Whoa. We need to turn that thing down or it'll hurt somebody.
If you got your Bibles this morning, I'd like you to turn them over to the book of St. Mark's Gospel. And I'm actually going to be preaching out of two different texts this morning. And so if I'm going back and forth, it's not that I'm confused, but it is the same story in two different Gospels, because we find this same story in Matthew's Gospel, and there's a piece of information there that's not found in St. Mark's Gospel. But I'd like to preach this morning, and I very rarely ever, I don't do real well with holidays. Holidays are hard to preach. Mother's Day, Father's Day, Easter, Christmas, because folks, you know, they in all fairness feel like that they've heard all the Mother's Day messages and all of the Father's Day messages and so forth that they can find. But before I get into the message this morning, let me tell you, I did a little bit of research this week, and somebody did some research, and they listed a little bit of all of the jobs that our mothers do. Between being a butler and a chauffeur and a cook and a nurse and whatever all they was. And they said that based on that, that our moms ought to be receiving somewhere in the neighborhood of $915 a week for a salary. Now, yeah, the lady said, shout, April, it'll be our... I've been waiting 2 years for April to move. I said that, and she looked at Jim. I thought she was going to shout. But I looked at that, and I began to think about, and I got to tell you, before I get into the message this morning, if you're able, if your mom is still around and you can hug her, and you can spend a little time with her, may I suggest today that you do that? Somebody told me this week, they said, preacher, I'm not going to be there Sunday because I'm going to church with my mom. And I think that they expected me to fuss at them. I said, go. Because I think if you can spend time with your mom, spend time with your dad, spend time with your family, I think that's a marvelous, marvelous thing. But I began to think about the influence that my mother had on me and the influence that moms have in general on their children. And I looked into the scriptures in my mind, and I began to visit some of the great women that are in the Bible, some of the great moms that are in the Bible. No doubt there have been great sermons that have been preached about some of those women. But this morning, I'd like to preach to you about the mom with no name. Only thing we know about her was that she was a mom. Now, for me, that's fitting. That we got a mom. I mean, you know, that it's mom with no name. The scripture doesn't tell us who she was. It just tells us what she did. So if you've got your Bibles, Matthew or St. Mark's Gospel, chapter 7. And I would begin to read in verse 24. It says, and from thence he arose, that would be the Lord, and he went into the borders of Tyre and Sidon, and entered into a house, and would have no man know it, but he could not be hid. For a certain woman, whose young daughter had an unclean spirit, heard of him, and came and fell at his feet. The woman was a Greek, a Syrophoenician by nation, and she besought him that he would cast forth the devil out of her daughter. But Jesus said unto her, let the children first be filled, for it is not meet to take the children's bread and to cast it unto the dogs. She answered and said unto him, yea, Lord, yet the dogs under the table eat of the children's crumbs. And he said unto her, for this saying, go thy way, the devil is gone out of thy daughter. Verse 30, and when she was come to her house, she found the devil gone out, and her daughter laid upon the bed. Now, I want to turn for just a moment, then I'm going to go back over to St. Mark's Gospel, but I want to turn to St. Matthew's Gospel because there is an important piece of information that I never knew till I began to read and do a little bit of research on this. In verse 21 of chapter 15 of St. Matthew's Gospel, it again says, Jesus went thence and he departed to the coast of Tyre and Sidon. Behold, a woman of Canaan came out of the same coast, cried unto him, saying, have mercy on me, O Lord, thou son of David, my daughter is grievously vexed with the devil. Verse 23 says it this way. But he answered her not a word. Now you see, in Mark's gospel, he spoke to her. So I found out that this is actually two different times that she came. Here it says that she came and she bowed down. She cried to him, have mercy. But he answered her not a word. And his disciples came, besought him, saying, send her away, for she crieth after us. But he answered and said, I am not sent, but unto the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Then it says in verse 25, then came she, worship him, saying, Lord, help me. But he answered and said, it is not meet to take the children's bread, cast it to the dogs. And she said, truth, Lord, yet the dogs eat the crumbs which fall from the master's table. And again, Jesus said, a woman, great is thy faith, be it unto thee, even as thou wilt. And her daughter was made whole from that very hour. Now, I want to speak to you this morning, and I'm not going to keep you long because I know it's Mother's Day, and everybody's got things that are going on, but there are a couple of things that I found out about this woman as I began to read and I began to study. And first of all, let me say, I believe that this woman was dedicated to her children. Now, how many of you all, let's just find out, this is audience participation. How many of you all would say in general that moms are dedicated to their children? Now, there you go. And you say, well, preacher, what in the world's that got to do with anything? Well, I got to tell you, I begin to think about how many times it is that moms lay awake in the middle of the night when I maybe was out doing things that I shouldn't have been doing and out being in places that I shouldn't have been being, but it never seemed to matter what time that I got home. Mom was always aware when I walked in the door. And you say, well, preacher, how do you know that? Because a lot of times she was sitting up on the couch. Now, if she was sitting up on the couch, that was not a good thing. Now, if she was just up in the room and she was awake, and you all know how it is. You all looking at me like deer in headlights this morning. But I remember sneaking in the house. You know, where's Dad? Dad, close your ears. We had it down pat. We had a sliding window in the basement of our bedroom. And, you know, it was ground level on the outside. But you could tap on that window just a little bit and the lock would come up. And you'd slide, I'm telling on myself, you'd slide it open and you'd sneak in and you never ever thought, but did you wonder this morning how it is that it seems like that moms always know when there's something going on with their children? That's because they're dedicated. Not only was this woman a dedicated mother, and you say, well, preacher, how do you get that? Because I believe that because of her dedication, it caused her to be desperate. It caused her to be desperate. And I don't mean to embarrass Sharon before I get into the message, but when I was thinking about this woman, it come to my mind that when Sharon was testifying about the fact when Caden was in the hospital and she was surrounded by everything that was in the hospital, all of the best doctors, all of the best care, but in her heart, she just didn't feel like that everything was the way it ought to be. And she said she got down right there in the hospital and she began to cry out to God. May I say to you this morning, if you've got a mother that's a praying mom and you've got one that's desperate enough to cry out to God on your behalf, you ought to get a hold of them today. Just hug them great big and thank them that they're desperate enough to pray. See, because we don't want to hear it when they pray most of the time. I know when I need prayer, when I needed it, you know, that's not exactly what you want to hear. My mamma, man, I tell you, mamma could get a hold of God. She could pray. And every now and again, when you get, you know, because we got them generic prayers, we begin to pray and we'll say, God, would you watch over my children? But when our children really get in trouble, when our children really got something that's coming a hold of them, I've heard women that'll get down by the altar and they'll begin to pray real soft. But all of a sudden, out of their belly, they'll begin to cry out. And you'll hear the pathos as it comes up out of their heart when they realize the desperate situation that their children in. And they know that they need God to move on their behalf. And when you're desperate, by the way, did you realize that you don't care what anybody else thinks about you? The Bible said that this woman came to Jesus and she fell down and she cried out to him. But if you look what the disciples said, they said, send her away. We don't want nothing to do with her. But I'm telling you, them people, they knew what she needed. They said, send her away. But she was desperate enough that she wouldn't let folks deter her from getting to where God was. Why? Because her daughter's in trouble. Moms, listen to the preacher. I'm not fussing. It's Mother's Day. I'm excited about it. Mom's Day is tough for me. But I'm excited about it. And you say, preacher, how can it be tough and exciting at the same time? Well, let me tell you how it can be tough. It can be tough because I don't get to hug my mom. But it can be exciting because I know one of these days I'm going to get to. But I begin to think about this, and I'm not fussing, but moms, listen to the preacher. I believe that we're living in a time that we need some desperate mothers. And you say, preacher, what are you talking about? I told some folk this week, I was talking to them about their children. And I began to talk to them about coming to God's house. And I told them, listen, there's things on the outside. If you don't bring your children up, if you don't begin to pray for them, if you don't bring them into God's house and set for them an example, there's things on the outside that's going to pull our children down. We've got some young folks that have been coming on Friday night, and they're trying to get their foot back up. And you say, well, they need to get it up from preacher. All the things on the outside that they say, well, you know what? Mom may not know if I do this. But honey, listen to me. When we get desperate enough that we begin to pray and cry out to God for our children, when we get desperate enough that we don't care what anybody else thinks, when we get desperate enough that we understand the only hope that they got is in the Lord, when we get desperate enough, we won't care what anybody else thinks. We'll do what we have to get to where the Lord is. And oh, by the way, if you're trying to get close to God, and it's not just for the moms, so that the dads and everybody else that's in here that may not have children understand this, when you're trying to get where the Lord is, there's going to be opposition. How many of y'all's ever, you know, just decided that you was going to spend some time in prayer? And you dedicated a time for prayer, and just about the time you got ready to pray, to pray, the phone rang. Nobody's had your phone go off when you got ready to pray. How about a knock on the door? Or how about a sick kid? Or how about something got to come up and you got someplace you got to go? But I'm telling you, this mother was desperate because she knew the only hope she had was God. She was dedicated. I believe she was desperate. And I believe because she was desperate, I believe she was driven. You say, well, preacher, how do you get that? Well, look what happens here. And I'm going to tell you now about both accounts at the same time in Matthew and Mark's gospel. In Matthew, the Bible said that she came to him. She bowed down and she began to cry out. And she said, would you have mercy? And the Bible said he uttered not a word. Now, I think she was desperate enough to be driven because she went a second time. Moms, how many of you all are willing? Moms, how many of you all are willing to pray a second time? Put your hand up. Now leave them up there a minute. Now let me ask you this, Mom, when your children's in trouble, how many of you all are not only willing to pray a second time or go a third time, but you're willing to go till God answers? Amen. Put the other hand up there. It'll be all right. Wait a minute. I'll tell you what. You all, every Mom in the building, put your hands up. Both of them. It'll be all right. Trina, that's you too. She's saying, man, all of you, put your hands up just a minute. Now, I want you all to look around. And you say, preacher, leave them up there. Don't get tired on me yet. Leave them up there. And you say, preacher, what in the world? I've got to tell you what. If we've got a group of moms in our church that are willing to lift up their hands to God when they become desperate and dedicated to their children, it'll not be long. And I don't, y'all can put them down now, but it'll not be long until every one of those moms begin to hear from God. And when they begin to hear from God, then you know what's going to happen. The very next thing that we're going to see is, whew, Christina, honey, I'm glad you're here. I'm going to embarrass her, not on purpose. They told us a few weeks ago, they said, we want you to pray for Christina. And she came to church and she sat over there on the other side and she wept and she wept and she wept. But she went out. But we didn't quit, and they didn't give up. They got desperate, and they began to pray a little more earnest. And then she came back, and even in the middle of a deacon ordination service, God touched her heart. And she listened. I don't know about the rest of you all, but I want your children in the church. I want them to come. And when they get here, I want them to understand that there's a group of folks that are desperate enough that we're driven, and we'll go to God until he answers. Amen. You see, I had a fella. I'm probably going to get myself in trouble, but it'll be all right. I had a fella. He was telling me, he said, you know, he said, after I ask God for something when I'm praying, he said, after I pray once, he said, I don't ask God anymore because God already knows and God doesn't forget anything. I thought about that, and I thought about that, and I thought about that. And then I thought about the woman, another one of them women that don't got no name in the Bible. She went to the unjust judge, and she began to cry out. And she left, and she came back. And she left, and she came back. And she left, and she came back. And you know what happened? Finally, the judge said, I don't know what that woman needs, but would you give it to her so she quits bothering me? How about we bother the throne room of God on behalf of our young people? How about if we petition the throne room of God on behalf of our children that the devil's pulling down and trying to get them in hell? But I say that there's still a praying mom that will stand in the way. I think she was driven out of desperation because the Bible said that her daughter was vexed with the devil. I don't know what you all call it. You can call it what you want to, but I know out there in our community, both in Marion and both in Delaware, they tell me that the heroin rate, it's raising and raising and raising and raising and raising. I told a preacher the other night that it's time that God's people stand in the way of that and tell our young people that they don't listen. I've got to tell you what, you don't got to shoot up to feel good. All you got to do is stand up and stand for God. And God will make you feel better than anything on the outside. Told that fella that we need to stand up. I believe that when we get desperate enough, I thought about it. The Bible said that this young girl was vexed with a demon, vexed with the devil, and her mom was driven because she knew that the only hope that she had was to go to God. She began to go there, and the first time that she went, she bowed down, and all she did was cry out. She said, have mercy on me. And the Bible said that he didn't utter a word. I began to think about that. And I wondered how many folks, listen to me, don't get aggravated at the preacher. But I wonder how many times that when we call on God and it doesn't seem like that God answers our prayer, that we just give up. May I say to you, she bowed down, cried out for help. But then the second time, the Bible said that she came back. You know what she began to do? She began to worship him. And I thought about that. Moms, listen to the preacher. Dads, listen. I'm going to tell you what. I hope that when my grandchildren come and my children, that they never see me ashamed to worship God in the good times and in the bad. She hadn't, my old man, I just now thought about something else. She hadn't got her answer yet, but she was determined she was going to get one. So she worshiped him ahead of time. Listen, if you've got children that are unsaved, if you've got family that are unsaved, worship God ahead of time. It'll be all right. Pay it forward. Get excited about what you've got. Your children will see the excitement and want what you got. Amen. Listen, I believe she was driven by her desperation because the Bible said that she came. Only this time when she came, she fell at his feet and she began to worship him. She was determined. By the way, when the disciples said to send her away, she began to talk to the Lord, and the Lord began to rebuke her again. First time, he didn't say anything, but she kept coming. Second time, he gave her a gentle rebuke. And he said, listen, It's not meant for me to take the things that belong to God's chosen people and give it to the dogs. Man, I thought about that. I mean, can you imagine if you was praying, if you was at the feet of Jesus and he looked and he said, you know, it's not meant for me to give what I got to the dogs. Now, I don't think he was calling her a dog. I think what he was saying is that there's a separation. There's a separation here. But she looked at that, and can you imagine? I wonder whether or not she felt rejected at that moment. First time he didn't talk to her. Second time he rebuked her, and he said, it's not meant for me to give you what I've got until the children have it. But I think if we have determination, if we become determined about what we're doing, how many of y'all are determined to build a church? Oh, man. Those of you that are determined, I might have to have you put up both hands for the others that didn't. If we become determined to build a church, let me tell you this morning that it isn't always going to work out the way we want it to. That don't mean we can quit. Sharon, honey,
amen.
How's our numbers?
Good.
Did you expect it to be as good as it was? Now, did you expect it to be that good before you got the answers? You know what that is? That's a determination. And you say, preacher, how do you know she was determined? Because she began to worship him and she called him by name before she got the answer. And you know what? We need some moms. We need some moms. And it's fitting. Where's Jan? It's fitting today that we've got the Kairos ladies that have been here. You know what those are? Those are moms. They are. They're moms that have determined that they can. There was one lady, and she wrote me. I got a two-page letter back there in my desk. I tried to read it this morning before service, but I mean, it's two pages, and there ain't anything missing. I mean, it's just, and I began to read it, and I thought, man, it's going to take me an hour to read this. I'll read it. But she had a double mastectomy. She had some other troubles in her life. But in her letter, you know what she said? I was determined I was going to serve God anyway. You know, if we get determined because we're desperate, because our children are in trouble, when we are driven by that desperation, it's going to make a difference. So she, you know, here's what she did. All of a sudden, moms, are you ready? She just opened up her heart to the Lord. First, she fell down and just cried for help. And then she opened up her heart. You know, I got to tell you, you all ever have trouble letting people into who you are? I mean, we don't let, we have a cloak that we want to put, and we don't let, you know, I think about that. And I thought this morning, I know you all going to think I'm goofy. But let me tell you how moms are sometimes. I was thinking as I was driving up the road this morning, and I'm old enough that I remember when Marvel Comics first came out with all of the superheroes, and they had Wonder Woman and all that, and I thought, man, she didn't have nothing on my mom. She didn't. You know, I mean, mom wasn't always dressed in fancy outfits. Sometimes it was an apron or a cleaning cloth. But mom raised three kids. Most time, dad had to work two jobs. Said something about us kids ate a lot. I don't know what that meant until after I... Was that an amen? But mom worked, took care of the house, took care of the kids, put herself through nursing school, and survived all of that. And in the meantime, she still let us know that she loved us. And I look back now, and I got to tell you why. By the way, for the moms, let me preach to your children just a minute. Children, you may not appreciate today what your parents are doing. You may not appreciate what your mom goes through. You may not appreciate everything that she does behind the scenes. But let me tell you, one of these days, you will. One of these days, you'll know that she was driven sometimes out of desperation. I mean, because, you know, and I don't know if mom ever did this. Dad could probably tell you better than I. But have you ever just throwed your hands up, mom, and said, don't know what I'm going to do with my kids? May I suggest that you do the same thing that this woman, whose name we do not know, did? She came, she bowed down, she cried for help, she began to worship, and then she just opened up her heart. Amen. Because the Lord said, you know, this is not the way it's supposed to be. And she looked and she thought, man, there's got to be some wiggle room here. So she thought a minute and she looked at him and she said, you know, Lord, you're right. Of course he was. And then she said, but, you know, if the crumbs fall, it's the responsibility of the dogs to clean up the crumbs. So, Lord, if you just let me have, now listen to me. If I could just have a crumb from the table, it'll suffice. Let me tell you what your children need. They need just a little piece of God in their lives. If they can just get a little bit of God in their lives, He can change their lives forever. I think about the Vacation Bible School, and I think about Friday nights, and I think about Wednesday nights, and everything that's going on with the church and with the children. And I'm telling you, if we can get just a little bit of God in them, He can do great things. And you say, well, preacher, how do you know that? Well, I think the last thing that I find about this woman, I think she was desperate, and I think she was determined, I think she was driven. But not only that, at the end, I think she was delighted. You say, well, how you, because when she got home, you know, I don't know how she got home. I don't imagine she walked. I expect she ran. The Lord said, your daughter's made whole. Now, you got to understand, her daughter wasn't with her. Some of you are separated from your children. May I say to you, that doesn't make any difference to God. No difference at all. You can be here and they can be there, but God can still touch them. Wherever they are, He can still reach them. When it feels like that they are unreachable, don't quit on God. God can reach them. She ran, I think. The Bible doesn't say that. It just said when she came into her house. I don't know how far away it was, but I got a notion she sprinted. You say, well, preacher, why do you say that? Because I think that she was desperately driven enough that she wanted to find out if just a little bit of God was enough to drive out the devil. Now listen to me. I think that if we pray and ask God, and God moves in the lives of our children, no matter what has a hold on them, and I'll close with this, and you all know my heart by now. I want to see the broken ones, and I want God to mend them. And it doesn't matter if God will just allow us to have a little bit, it'll be sufficient. It'll be sufficient for whatever need that they have. God can take a word when we think that nothing is happening, and when it doesn't feel like to us that it's going out. God said, my word will not go out void, but it'll reach its intended purpose. So you may just tell your child, God loves you. That may be all you get to tell them, but that little bit of God can change their life forever. You say, well, I'm not seeing the change happen. Well, she didn't see it immediately. She had to go from where he was to where they were. Sometimes, going from where he is to where they are will make enough of a difference in their lives that they'll accept the Lord. You see, this mom with no name, it's fitting that she didn't have a name. Fitting. Mom with no name. Of all the great women in the Bible, she came, she was desperate because her daughter had a demon. She was driven out of that desperation, that even when people tried to deter her, she was determined to get an answer from God. And when she got that answer from the Lord, I believe she was delighted with the result. I got to tell you what, if we can bring our children to the Lord, we ought to be delighted with the result. There's enough stuff on the outside that's trying to bring them. But if we got praying moms and praying dads and a praying church, and we are determined, I believe it'll make a difference in the lives of our children. She was a great woman because she knew the only hope that her child had. Her daughter was vexed with a demon. There's a lot of demons that are out there, a lot of things that's got a hold of our children. She knew the only hope. I wonder if this woman had tried everything else. I wonder if she'd tried church. Church didn't work. You say, well, preacher, you can't say that. You're trying to build a church. I'm trying to build relationships with the Lord. If we have those, he'll build a church. I wonder if she tried all of the other things that was out there. And finally, the Bible said here that she heard of him. She knew from the things that she heard, if I can just get a word with him, it'll make a difference in my daughter's life. You see, it wasn't even about her. It was all about her daughter. I think this Mother's Day that it is fitting that we have a sermon on a mom with no name, just simply called Mom. That's what she was. She was desperate enough for her daughter that she desired for the demons to be gone, that she ran to the only hope that she had. I wonder today, are you desperate? If you're not, there's going to come a time that you will be. And I'll tell you, when you get to that point, run to him. Run to him. He'll make a difference in your life. So, Brother Kyle, if you'd come to the piano.